Hello, my name is Jude Osara. I specialize in developing engineering tools and processes for performance and state of health analysis of systems undergoing unsteady and nonlinear interactions that often lead to instability and failure. Professor Michael Bryant and I at the University of Texas in Austin developed the new Degradation-Entropy generation, DEG, methodology for instantaneous characterization of nonlinear, multi-physics, multi-scale system process interactions. In other words, an analysis approach applicable to all active systems at near 100% accuracy. Professor Bryant and I recently published a few technical papers detailing the new DEG methods. As the readership and interest in our publications and technology continue to grow, I have received a number of inquiries regarding what the DEG does and how it does it. So in this video, I will break down the fundamentals underlying the technology. I will attempt to simplify energy transformations and degradation from an intuitive perspective, one you are not likely to find in any existing textbook. Some of the discussions here would be included with more details in an upcoming technical paper. One primary motivation here is to guide current and future researchers and graduate students, as well as industry engineers and system analysts, in their fundamental understanding of energy transformations. A certain level of energy basics is essential to proper interpretation of the DEG results. So this video potentially makes other publications easier to follow. All right, let's get to it. Most devices, for example, cell phones, computers, cars, and so on, undergo loads at unsteady rates. However, during design stages, manufacturers combine steady-state analysis tools with hundreds and thousands of data sets to calibrate the component's response under various conditions. These tests can be very expensive and add to total manufacturing costs. In addition, sudden failures and warranty claims remain incessant. Even with the recent rise in machine learning capabilities, device failures are still largely unpredictable. With the new DEG methods, manufacturers can adequately characterize their components using data directly measured from the device in situ operation. Also, when choosing suppliers for components, manufacturers can more accurately compare performance and degradation characteristics without the need for complex tools and processes. Real-time state of health monitoring is another direct application of the DEG methodology. You may already be familiar with the concept of energy conservation, which essentially tells us that energy can only be transferred from one form to another. This statement can be written in many ways depending on what science field is under consideration. Thermodynamics has the most complete version of energy conservation statement, commonly known as the First Law of Thermodynamics. For a stationary non-reacting system, excluding gravitational effects, its most widely used form states, the change in internal energy of a system is equal to the sum of the net heat transferred to the system and the net work obtained from it. This law, though universally true, often raises questions that are difficult to answer. For example, it is well known that all real energy transformations occur with losses, also known as energy dissipation. But if you examine the first law in this form, it is not obvious which term includes the losses, even though we know the losses are there and increase as the system degrades. It turns out these losses are primarily included in the internal energy changes, but are difficult to separate from other sources of internal energy changes. Note that this form of the first law is a direct artifact of early applications of thermodynamics to systems that convert heat directly into work or vice versa, such as combustion engines, refrigerators, and heat pumps. Thereafter, the second law of thermodynamics introduced the concept of entropy to establish the possibility and directionality of energy transformations, after which other forms of the first law were developed. These new forms replaced internal energy with free energy or thermodynamic potential. We will consider the two most commonly used potentials for non-thermal systems. The first one is the Helmholtz free energy, which defines the maximum work a monotonically active system can possibly output. And the second is the Gibbs free energy, which defines the maximum compositional change a system can undergo. Each is made up of two primary terms. The Helmholtz free energy transformation consists of actual work output and what we call the internal free energy dissipation, while the Gibbs free energy change is the sum of actual compositional changes and again the free energy dissipation. The bottom one here applies to reactive systems including batteries. Notice that they both have a common theme. They both express energy transformations as the actual energy available for work or compositional change and the unavailable energy due to losses and other degradation effects. Then we can combine them into one statement, that the free energy is the sum of available and unavailable energy. Note that I have used the color code here that indicates the green region is free energy, blue is output work or internal reactions. The light red shaded region is the rise in thermal energy. The dark red region represents the irreversibilities at the energy conversion or transformation interface. Irreversibility in the context here is another word for energy degradation. So then here is what's happening in plain words. When you use a device or load a system in technical parlance, the device's free energy, the gray region, starts to transform into output work, the blue region, which is basically whatever you are using the device for. At the same time, a fraction of the free energy degrades and dissipates inside the device, the red region. This is the fraction there causes your device to heat up as you use it, as experienced in batteries, electronic components, and so on. So the green region is transforming into the blue and the red region as the device is in operation. Now one can examine this graphical expression here and deduce a number of things. The free energy content of a monotonically transforming system between two states is predetermined before process interaction, which then implies that an increase in unavailable energy will reduce the available energy. Think about it as a sick person having less available energy than when the same person with the same free energy is healthy. Also, optimization can be used to minimize unavailable energy and maximize available energy. In plain words, this is universally good while this is universally bad from an energy utilization perspective. Note that the word system here simply refers to all things. It can be seen that the free energy balance is more convenient, perhaps more appropriate, for characterizing energy changes in an active non-thermal system than the original common internal energy equation, which was primarily intended for heat engines. I should point out that the free energies include and therefore are consistent with the first and second laws of thermodynamics. So based on the above breakdown, it is not far-fetched that the degradation of a system's free energy or maximum work possible will adequately indicate the system's performance and degradation or ill health. This is essentially the premise of the DEG methodology, which linearly relates a system's degradation to its entropy generation. Think about entropy generation as you would energy degradation. Another significant observation is that the absence of unavailable energy means the system can use all of its free energy for actual work. Such a system is considered ideal and does not naturally exist, which is why the term maximum work denotes theoretical maximum. However, under controlled conditions, a system can achieve pseudo-steady state during which energy degradation is minimal. Currently, most, if not all, analysis approaches, including thermodynamics-based ones, use the steady-state assumption. But in actual operation, most components or devices are hardly in steady state, thereby leading to inaccurate system health diagnosis and failure prediction. With the new DEG methods, we do not make any assumptions. We characterize the system along its natural response path, which we then use to predict its behavior. Now, with entropy defined as energy divided by temperature, what we have done is take the original DEG theorem statement by Professors Bryant, Kosari, and Ling, and apply it to our free entropies to form the new and universal DEG methodology for instantaneous system characterization. The expression free entropies is what we are calling the entropy terms derived from the free energy formulations. The DEGB coefficients are the proportionality constants that characterize the entropy versus degradation relationship. The blue region is the degradation from the system's output work, also the boundary work or applied load, while the red region represents the degradation from internal energy dissipation, which we call the microstructural thermal MST degradation. As observed previously, the boundary or load degradation is universally favorable, while the MST degradation is universally adverse. Note that the load degradation is the minimum degradation the system will undergo at the given process rate if the process is to actually take place in reality. It is important to understand this constraint by nature on all things when interpreting the word favorable in the context of degradation. All things in nature degrade spontaneously, so the goal is to slow down degradation, and to do this, we need to minimize the MST component. Graphically, we have presented this information in the form of a three-dimensional orthogonal space we call the DEG domain. The height or vertical axis is the user-defined convenient degradation measure. The horizontal pair of axes consists of the load or boundary or output entropy defining the width, and the MST entropy defining the depth. Based on our discussion so far, we can now infer that a relatively shallow DEG domain, which means low MST entropy, is always desired for improved performance. Our studies show that these analysis features and results interpretations are consistent with all systems, thus forming the basis of the new DEG methodology. Now, how does a device manufacturer, designer, researcher, or analyst put this methodology to use? Currently, we have performed several system analyses and are in the process of demonstrating real-time diagnostic monitoring. In a subsequent video, I will perform lubricant analysis using a DEG-based program I created. Well, that is the simplified version of the fundamentals of the DEG methodology. More related content can be found on ResearchGate and on my LinkedIn profile, where I often post research and development updates. Thank you very much for watching. Stay curious.